said, my name's Aaron Smith, Cold War veteran. I served in the military overseas from 1975 to 1978 before the wall came down. She talked about a little bit about being on alert. I was in Army Air Defense. My original goal was to go into the military as a chaplain, okay? Humble, spiritual, and all that. I was brought up in the church. Take a little bit about my early upbringings. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Homewood isn't much like it used to be when I grew up. I'm from the 50s, early 60s. Everybody knew everybody. Butler, staying in Butler now, that kind of reminds me of the way Pittsburgh used to be. Okay. And large family on both sides, my mom and dad. My dad's from Roanoke, Virginia. 15 kids. My mom is from Jacksonville, Florida. 18. So as growing up, I had a lot of aunts and uncles. So both parents worked. My dad worked at U.S. Harry Thompson Steelworks. My mom worked at Spoil. She did housework. And we were always surrounded by family. I gotta let you know that I'm a baby boy. All my brothers, sisters, were in the military. My oldest brother was in the Air Force, on the Korean War. Two brothers after him. One was in the Army, stationed over in Germany, going to Vietnam War. We thought he was going to Vietnam. His twin was in the Navy, went to Vietnam. Okay. Plus, I had a sister, 4 years older than me, that went to Vietnam. So, you're all deceased. There's a lot of pain and hurt there, and that's why I'm here to tell you that we did recover. Before going into the military, they were my heroes. The one that was stationed in Germany, came home and was killed. And at the time, I had to go identify the body. And he was my hero. He was the one that was closest to me. And the trauma that seeing his wife standing there, like in a cloud, and his body laying in the street, and she cried, that haunted me. I carried that with me. From the seminary, finished high school, computer tech, even when I went into the military. It was like a scene from a movie, like Gone with the Wind, or, you know, you can't believe, you're hoping that this dream is a dream and it will go away. But after that, you know, all my hopes and dreams died. I wanted to be an astronaut. I was very smart growing up. I love science. I love math. I love the history. I can tell you about the Susquehannocks. I can tell you about General Braddock's death march from Frankstown and Braddock Avenue, straight out to North Braddock. I can tell you about the George Washington Trail, all these little trails that they have around here. Some of them are famous. But anyway, I was unusually different. I looked different. I talked different. I was into the Beatles. I was into Four Seasons. I was just, they said, a lot of my brothers and sisters, friends, said, that's a brother. Because I had no red hair, and they were dark skin. My dad met my mom when she was, had just got a divorce. She had six kids, and she had just lost my older sister, Hattie, to a drunk driver. So there was a lot of depression. There was a lot of, my family was dysfunctional to some degree, and there was a lot of crime, there was a lot of drink, and that's what they did, man. And I hated that. Later on, drinking would become my best friend because I was able to cope. Needless to say, between August and September, those are my hardest months. All from the time that I graduated and all the way up through when I decided to go to the seminary, stigma. And what seeing my brother land there in that casket, my hero, and I have a sister with Down syndrome, I didn't know she had feelings. Seeing her cry, I was done. Everything that I had, dreams, going to college, becoming somebody famous, that all left. So what I did was after graduating from Westinghouse High School, went to computer tech, and believe it or not, they were more concerned about the Vietnam veterans. That was their first priority. So they got the chance to use the mainframe. If you know Fortran and COBOL, it's like the caveman. Things have changed drastically, and my grades went down. So I decided to go and be like my brother. I went into the all-volunteer army. I signed up for Germany, and like I said, I wanted to be a chaplain. They said, "No, we're gonna make you a radar technician." It took me 5 months to get the top secret security clearance because I was the person that go in there and fix. They weren't computers; they were like air defense modules. Some stuff I can't talk about, it's top secret, but we were hot missiles. We were usually stationed near the border. We were mobile. When the colonel called us up to make a move, if it was a skirmish or the area was hot, they would call us up. I was stationed in Boots Pot. It was like 34 Ks outside of Darmstadt, where all this person was stationed. Our attack site was 5 Ks up in the mountains from where his guest house was. He walked to work, but where he stayed at, they made it into a hotel. So, make a long story short, you see the anxiety starting to kick in. I'm gonna jump around a little bit, fast forward. I was close with a young guy who was from Texas. He was about 20, brought his wife up. And just one time, we normally got paid on Fridays we got paid on the base. But this time, it was this captain from Beaver Falls wanted to make a show and made us go to the tax site. So needless to say, this young kid, he brought his wife and his baby girl. He jumps on his motorcycle and he's flying up to go to the tax site, flying up. And a truck hit him and smashed him. And we're on the back of this deuce and a half. We're headed up to the tax site and we're riding past. And we see him laying there and his legs just flipped like this. And here it is. His wife just came over. He's a father. She had nothing left in the unit, and the morale of the unit went down. Needless to say, I wanted to quit. Anytime I got depressed, anything that I was doing, I would quit. Even the seminary, I quit. In the military, I tried to quit. they said I took my field gear, my M16, put it in my duffel bag, threw it out the window, went downstairs and said, "I quit." And full-blown colonel came up and said, "What's wrong with you, son?" He said, "I quit." He said, "You can't quit." I said, "I'll tell you, I'm going to quit." And I told him where to go. And I should have been court-martialed, but he realized that our unit was the best, Bravo 359 air defense unit in Germany. That we just didn't carry on like that. And he seen that there was something wrong with it. And it would take me 30 to 27 years later to remember what he said. Needless to say, I got 2 Article 15, but I kept my rank. I came out as an E4 specialist. Oddly discharged, I finished my tour. I thought I was done. I came out and joined the reserves. I got 6 years in the reserves and day of practice, they had these usurers where all of Europe came into this mode where World War III was going to start. So, like, the night before, we would have all our gear, all the trucks loaded up, the missiles on the launchers, ready to go. And when that siren went off, all the Allies would go to their stations, you know, the groups, the whole nine yards. And I carried that with me even after getting out of the military. I was always paranoid, worried about somebody breaking into my house. Kids would always say, "Dad, what's wrong?" And then there was periods of times when I would just break down and cry because they couldn't understand. I have two girls who are 26, 27, they're not twins. I have a little boy, or he's not a little boy, he's 23, and my oldest is 40. And I haven't been in his life a lot, but he still loves me. He understands that I did have a problem. He works for the Pentagon. My daughters accept me. They knew something was wrong. Whereas my baby boy doesn't. He doesn't understand the military aspect of what I went through. I hear my sister cry coming back from Vietnam. Wonder why is she crying? What is she going through? Feeling so helpless. And then after my brother died, going through those same things, having the same feelings. Being in that state, I was lonely, I wasn't confused. Alcohol made me normal. And after years of that, I was functional. I went to work, kept the job, but I couldn't get over the hump. I couldn't start something and finish it. I worked at John Kane Hospital. After my dad died, I quit that. I ended up taking care of my mom. She had Alzheimer's. Then I put her in the home, and that was it. You know, I was like the rock. The pain, the stigma. Back in the 60s, if you had a problem with mental illness, they sent you two places, Western Psych or Woodfield. After my brother died, I'm going to skip around, I'm going to make this short. Up until 2008, you couldn't get me to say one or two words about this. You know, I always kept it inside. My kids didn't know anything about this. I decided to come up the button. I got my CDLs. I was tired of the hurt. OVR paid for it. I decided to come up the button to get some help with PTSD and a major depression. It took my great-great-nephew. My brother that was killed had a daughter who ended up taking care of me, which he never saw. And her son said, "Uncle Bo, how come you in that? How come you in the bedroom all the time? Why don't you come on out?" He said, "Why don't you? I'll buy you something to drink if you take me to Toys R Us." And now what's the question? On a Sunday to Monroeville from Wilkinsburg. And that was the bottom of the bottom. You know, him knowing that I was an alcoholic, 9 years old, wouldn't take a bath, sleeping in parks. Before she rescued me, I was sleeping in an abandoned house. I went from shelter from a Presbyterian church in East Liberty. It was 50 guys to two shires, and the shires were as dark as his shirt, but they were supposed to be white. I met two guys in there who were veterans, who I need to say they did recover too. One works for the transitional house in Pittsburgh, and the other one is works for, I want to say, Blade Run, as a peer special. Butler saved my life. And I want to say this here. could say one veteran, the effect that that one veteran you say affects the whole community. It affects his family, his neighbors, the people that he grew up with. He becomes a productive member of society. And what's being able to talk about the problem and let it go? Those storms still come, but you can overcome those storms. You know, they're just, you don't have to carry the baggage with you. It's like carrying a dead body everywhere you go. You're still carrying yourself. This time when I made that decision to come up to Butler to surrender, because we're told to fight till the end, you don't ask for help, you hold that line. You fight at all costs. And being stationed overseas, it was an honor to be in the all-volunteer army, protecting my country, which I love. I came up to Butler. I asked for help. For some reason, Western Pennsylvania has the best mental health. Not only for the veterans, but for the common people, you know, kids. Like Butler has a program called The Path for teenagers. They also have CCR, Center for Community Resources. I'll tell you a little bit about that. After graduating from the program up at the VA, I was hired in Pittsburgh to work housekeeping, but that job was frozen. So I decided to join America. I said, well, I'll volunteer to give something back. Because to tell you the truth, AmeriCorps got me in to doing peer support. I was a mentor for civilians that were struggling with abuse, cutting, the whole nine yards, and they had a program called the Hope Project. I met people on the LHOT committee, the local housing options team, which all the whole community works together to end this problem of mental illness or to help people who have been abused mentally and physically, whether you're a veteran or not. They have a program up there on the campus called The Shop, which serves the community and some of the veterans. CCR, the VA served my life, saved my life. CCR gave me hope. AmeriCorps gave me my dream. And with that, I was brought on to work with the Homeless Initiative. It was a five-year program, which is supposed to end this year, to end homelessness among the veterans, to make sure that the veterans returning have a place to go. I am a voc rehab specialist, but I wear many hats. It's called community-based employment services. I was the first 100 hired to work with the veterans. We went to Boston, and I shared up in Boston how Butler, Pennsylvania, how there's so many agencies working together on the same path to make the area better. So I met her. So I met Karen Zapp with AmeriCorps Care and Fair with Catholic Charities. So I'm gonna end this. The thing of it is, it's so hard to be normal after being on alert and being a veteran. You know, you always want to go that extra step. But whether it's positive or negative, if you don't ask for help, you're just lost. You're just another person out there committing a crime. Sometimes to get a person to understand where you're coming from is the hardest thing. For me, it took me 27 years. I need to let you know that I'm in DC3, studying to be social work. I did graduate from the seminary, but I went to the Metro Urban Institute. I got a certificate in community ministry. I plan on going to Geneva College to finish up my degree. I'm a certified recovery specialist. I work with people with addictions. And I'm a peer specialist, certified peer specialist.
guys and all these different organizations that people I have met along this journey, I wouldn't be here. We're one of the greatest countries on the face of this earth. And what we need to do is just listen. Put some more of that money back into the community. Take care of our own and the rest will come. We need to take care of our own instead of pumping money to our enemies. We need to do for ourselves and build our own house up before we start to build somebody else's house. And stigma, pain, pride, isolation, all that's part of PTSD. And the sad thing about it, I thought I was the only person fighting this battle alone. You have one of the Kennedys, who is an outspoken person, who speaks